Marker.
Cause it's a pain. A destiny child, you know it will be rocking cause it's fucking insane. It's just a pain. A destiny child, more precious than a diamond on a platinum chain.
Me and KG started the band Tenacious D for real back in like the summer of 94. Right, Cage?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great.
Like 12 years ago.
Wow. In our first few years, we were just a band playing clubs. Then we got a TV show in 97.
On HBO.
And then in 2001, we had our first album. It actually took 7 years to make our first record.
And it was always going really good, and people were always really responding positively and laughing and loving our show. And
you guys changed people's lives tonight.
And we never really knew why.
When you're watching them, you're superimposing, knowing what they wish they were.
Yeah!
And that's what makes you enjoy them, because you can tell that they're playing acoustic guitars, but in their heads, they're hearing them as electrics and they're hearing drums, and that's that what they wish they were. And you kind of want that for them, and you want to give it up for them.
Back in those days, we were just like, you know what would be the most awesome thing? Would be to have a movie. And we finally reached the pinnacle of our quest.
What we got's gonna turn your brain into shit.
It really came from Jack, Liam, and Kyle, who came up with the idea of telling an origin story and the whole idea of the pick of destiny. We originally tried, we being Red Hour Films, originally tried to do a Tenacious D movie, God, like 6 or 7 years ago. Had some writers come on and the writers had a story, and it was really something that was sort of constructed from the outside, and it simply didn't work. There was no way to really kind of capture the appropriate energy and the attitude of those guys.
Jack and I were just talking one night, and he was kind of bummed out because they really wanted, you know, they want to make a movie, and I was like, I don't know why you're expecting people to tell you how to be the D, because you are the D. You just need help in organizing. And he was like, dude, you gotta help us write this, and we did. And we wrote 4 or 5 movies before we got to this one.
Writing the script is a lot like when we write songs. It's the same process where first we need the concept. What's the funny idea that we want this song to be?
His fingers move with blinding speed. Within my mind he'll plant the seed. I'm proud to be amongst his learned flock.
And once we get that, what we're gonna sing about, and we think that's funny, the song just sort of spills out, kind of flows like wine. And the same thing happened with the script. It was like, what is it exactly? What are we gonna tell here? And once we nailed it,
yeah. We're
like, that's the fucking thing.
And then we just went 50 nights and 50 days. Every single day, no days off. And we knew what it was, and we had honed in and sort of seen the story coming through the fog, and we were there.
We didn't try to reinvent the wheel. We said, wait a minute, what's the favorite stuff in the D world? We're gonna bring all those characters that you loved back, and we're gonna give them a budget. We're gonna give them better makeup. We're gonna give them better effects. We're gonna give them CinemaScope.
It's Tenacious D Deluxe.
It's still the open mic night. You know, we try to get a lot of familiar faces in there from the episodes, like Sasquatch, like Paul F. Tompkins. I wanted to stay true to the lore of the D for the hardcore fans, and I wanted to have it make sense around the HBO episodes. I imagine this episode's happening maybe a year after this story happened.
They must pay the rent.
The Pick of Destiny is kind of two stories in a way. It's the history of the D and how they've come to meet each other, and kind of their first big adventure and bonding experience together.
We wanted to make the Citizen Kane, if you will, of Carmody.
Citizen D.
If the D is gonna win that prize money, we're gonna have to write a fucking masterpiece! Are you with me?
Totally.
Powerhouse.
In the HBO episodes, there was always talk about friendship and everything, but it was always really, really light. And I really wanted to feel the love, like for real, and see instances with them together where it's just like, oh. You know, I feel like it has to have that heart so you know how much they love each other. And anybody who's had a best friend can relate to that. And in the end, for me at least, the Pick of Destiny is really the pick that Kyle flicks at Jack, which made them destined to meet and care about each other.
Because we're playing as from the inception, so it's like eight years ago, I had to gain weight for the role.
Let me have the fried chicken.
and a steak. And the chicken fried steak.
I did it. I gained 50, and I'm like, oh, is it health issue? What is it? I said, no, I don't know. There's no health issue in my art. So we're playing ourselves, but it's a version of ourselves that I guess is the most honest.
I like to think that I'm smarter than the character I play in Tenacious D.
Yeah.
It's going pretty good until I messed up with it.
At least a little bit smarter.
I'd like to think that I'm more talented than my character.
Yeah, Kyle Gass project. It's got some pretty breakthrough shit on it. I'm trying to keep it on the hush-hush.
Your character's talented in the movie.
I know, that's why he's so good at it. More talented.
They're super talented, and the songs are really good, and really funny. And they're riveting to watch.
Dude, what's the matter?
Dude?
Aren't you hungry? You should eat something.
No, I never eat before a mission. It slows you down. I gotta be light on my feet like a dancer. Like a fucking ninja, dude. Now check this out. I'm gonna jump this fence here, okay? Like a gazelle. Then you come around that fucking bend. Damn it, Kyle. If we're gonna do this, you gotta stay focused. Eye of La Tigre.
Jack is a classic frontman, you know? He's got the energy and presence and vocal abilities.
Can't you see? He's the man. Let me hear you applaud. He is more than the man. He's the shiny golden god.
If you think it's time to fucking rock and fucking roll out of control, well, then you know you've got to run the block. You fucking sock my fucking cock.
Jack is a super dynamic character. He does two or three takes, and they're really funny, but he's just starting.
Go, play something. Go fast, the magic only lasts a second. No, don't play fast, I said start fast, but keep going, yes. Try to make it prettier. Stop judging yourself, you're judging yourself, that's why that riff sucks. No fucking mental blocks.
Kyle, I think, is a little more of the straight musician.
Right in there.
You think of him as a straight man, but that's mostly because Jack is so animated. An octopus is a straight man next to Jack.
Hey! I think Ben in Search of Sasquatch is on.
Hold on. Give me that fucking remote.
Who are you?
And of course, they also have a great sense of humor. You know, they just know how to make people laugh.
Oh my God, you guys, what are you doing here? Come on in.
Lee is very, very crucial, we find out, in the history of Tenacious D.
There was no Lee, there would have been no D fans.
Right.
And what is a band without fans?
Uncle Ben at the meeting, you guys!
And cut. Let's do another one. Your turn was a little fast. Just like, knock him dead at the, you know.
Tell him to yell it for real. It sounded like a little constipated.
I actually looked like you were on a Lazy Susan.
Dude, yell it for real. It sounded like you were a little constipated on that one.
My character is sort of a sidekick slash psycho fan of the D. By happenstance, I become their friend. I end up delivering them a pizza.
Here's your Zah.
And see them going through some musical concert practicing, and I get to come in and watch them and become their pal.
The thing about Lee is he's even dumber than the D.
Where are you guys?
Well, we're at the drive-in. We're watching this bitch in movie. It's Cop Chase 3. Have you seen it?
No, I haven't seen that one. Sounds scary, though.
Which makes the D feel kind of smart. They love them.
You just seem like rock and roll types to me.
We had some incredible people in this film, and a lot of our favorite people.
We have some great actors playing roles that are much smaller than they would normally play.
What you seek is the pick of destiny.
I think there's a light switch back here.
No, you don't.
Now, I know funnest isn't really a word.
Yeah.
But I would say the funnest part, one of the funnest parts, is casting all our friends in the movie.
Yep.
There it is. Oh, man. No, right there.
So.
No, wait. Right there. Oh, man.
Yeah. What were we That's saying good. About acting? We don't have a lot of cameos.
It's not a ton.
We don't have as many as, say, the Blues Brothers, where, like, every minute there would be another rock and roll or R&B legend.
Yeah.
We didn't cram them in there like that. We did have some friends of ours that are in there that are really funny.
What happened to your eye?
I fell down some stairs. What do you want?
What happened to your eye?
Fuck off, dude.
Oh, sweet baby!
There's a lot of action. Robert Brinkman, my DP, said a funny thing, which was like, when this movie starts, it's kind of like the movie least likely to have a car chase.
You see my intensity? I knew I had to bring all of the mustard because there was only one take. They said, Jack, we got to get this in one. And I said, no problem.
And then the entire museum sequence, there's a lot of big scenes. Stay back here, devise a plan, dive into the bushes. Against all odds, infiltrate, stop the games.
Stop the games. Ninja style, samurai. Stop the games. Damn.
Pretty sure that this ending will go down in history as like one of the great endings of all time.
The devil is really just the ultimate evil cartoon villain. I like the theatricality of it. I'm the devil, I can
do what I want. Well, I just want to say that I'm a huge fan. I always have been.
He doesn't want to be revealed, so I won't say who is playing the role of Satan.
We got to do a tour down there.
Well, we've been waiting for you.
Okay, yeah.
But, I know how it goes.
Yeah. No, we'll go down.
We'll go down. When you come down?
Yeah.
I'll hook you up.
All right.
Anything you need.
Dude, when we come down, we're there to stay.
Oh, yeah.
Hopefully it'll be not for a little while.
Yeah, that might be sooner than you think.
Ah, screw it. I'm gonna tell him. We actually got Satan. So I was stoked. He doesn't do a lot of movies.
He uses the stage name, Dr. G.
My motion picture debut, and I think it might be the only time I'm ever in a movie. I think this is gonna be my one role, and I'm thinking it's Oscar time. The makeup's good. I mean, it's kind of a long process, but it's not as uncomfortable as you'd imagine it to be. So it's cool. Like, for a guy that grew up listening to death metal, to be in a movie as Satan looking like this is kind of, it's awesome. Satan rocks, But D's pretty badass, but when it comes to rock and roll, can't beat the devil.
You know what Satan's like? Charming, super intelligent, and really friendly. There's a lot of moments where we go into their heads, and that was a good vehicle to kind of go into a different movie and have some surprises.
Oh my God, Sasquatch!
Labels, what's up?
Jack's mushroom trip with Sasquatch. We just wanted to derail the movie and make a completely different movie. It's probably like one of my favorite parts. It was the part I was most looking forward to shooting. I would just keep going back to my schedule. How many weeks till I get to film the Sasquatch scenes?
We're in Jack's hallucination.
We started in a forest on location, and then we came onto this set, which in one stage right before this, it was not as colorful, and there was fake real trees. And this stage, we've then taken out the round trees, brought in the flat trees, and then we go down the rapids on the Strawberry River model, basically a la Land of the Lost. We're gonna shoot them in inner tubes on green, and then we're gonna comp that into a model that we're shooting.
This is Sasquatch's second appearance in a motion figure. We've known him since the HBO shows. We had a chance to work with him, and he's very professional.
But that, like, his dream would be that Sasquatch would be his dad, and like his idea of something awesome is that like Sasquatch is telling him he's an awesome rocker, and then like telling him stories and loving him is pretty special.
I love you too, Davey. You're an awesome rocker.
Everybody loves baby Sass. There's nothing I can do about it.
He's a mysterious character, Sasquatch. I don't know what he is. Is he the missing link between ape and man? All I know is that we got the real Sasquatch in our film.
He's a force of nature, and his performance in the film is astounding.
Hey, what's up?
Me and KG wrote the song 5 minutes ago. It's called Master Exploder.
Master Exploder is when Jack's dreaming. It's really what I imagine the D feeling like they are when they're on stage, and sort of all the balls that Jack will have and the attitude of being so awesome. It's really just great visual representation of what I feel they feel like they are. Barney went above and beyond. He did the exploding head and Master Exploder.
What we did is we came up with a silicone likeness of the actor. We made this so we can do many takes. We have a hollow area in the head, and eventually his head will explode because Jack Black rocks so hard, he actually blows his mind. That'll be a air ram that forces at high pressure. Brain matter and blood and viscousy material just right out through the top.
Sorry. I did not mean to blow your mind.
Will that be a working rig when we get in the bottom of the head?
I am a hardcore Tenacious D fan. I think I know a lot about Tenacious D.
Liam actually went on a couple tours with us where he was on the bus and just watching it all happen, which really makes it so fitting for him to be directing this film because he really knows the D inside and out.
All right, let's do it.
We couldn't have done it without him, really.
He did the tribute video.
He directed that.
And that was, it just went so good.
He's done albums of his own. A couple months before we started this whole thing, had a hit on the radio of a song that he wrote, The United States of Whatever.
We were in the middle of working on the script, yeah. And then all of a sudden, this song starts playing on the radio. I was like, what's happening, Liam? You have a hit song on the radio?
Dude, we were in like
Denmark. And he was like, yeah, man, I didn't have a record deal or anything. I just sort of sent a disc over to a radio station and they started playing it. I've never heard of such a thing.
I come from music background. Sort of went the route of music, and I studied in Liverpool with Paul McCartney. And had a TV show on MTV called Syphil and Ollie, and I wrote and directed that with a friend of mine. But all the time, I was always making films. Even since I was a little kid making Super 8 movies.
It definitely helped that Liam was a musical dude and understood Tenacious D, not just from the comedy side, but from the musical side.
And, yeah, totally.
And he brought a lot to the table, and we actually wrote a song with him in the movie.
Liam is really unlike anyone I've ever met in my life. He's wicked. I mean, he's really smart. He's really funny. He's really talented. He's a great director. He's directed videos for us before. The Queens of the Stone Age stuff that he's done is amazing. The Eagles of Death Metal stuff that he's done is amazing. And he's just super talented. I think he's gonna be doing this for a long time.
All right, man. This is it. Don't make a sound unless it's a masterpiece. Not a fucking sound.
I would call it a musical adventure movie. That was the whole point of the D. You wanna hear the tunes, you know, and have fun.
It's part of what drives the film because it's part of the characters of Tenacious D, that they're musicians trying to make it in the world of rock.
It's a wonderful energy because they're celebrating rock, but bringing sort of this simple, folky musicality to it with their, you know, humorous selves.
It just happened that we hadn't done the second album. Even though we've been together 12 years, we never rush anything, so. By the time the second album was due, we were working on the movie, and we thought, why not make the soundtrack? We wrote over 1,000 new songs, but unfortunately we couldn't use them all, so we whittled them down to about 6 new ones.
The first album was just all these funny songs that we had strung together over the years, and this album, all the songs sort of fit into the story, furthering the narrative, as mm-hmm. it were, in our little musical extravaganza.
There was a lot of times when we needed a song in a certain, you know, when writing the script, you go, well, at this point, we need this song where it's like a dream sequence.
Jack dreams about having the pick when we have to have a song there. Sort of little assignments that we gave ourselves.
We had some bitchin' guest stars on the album. The opening musical number starts off with Meat Loaf, Ronnie James Dio, and me and Kyle, and it's just like...
And that's before the opening credits.
One of the very first things about this movie, before we had the story written, we knew that we were gonna have to write a kick-ass song and that Meat Loaf would have to play Jack's dad. We didn't know what the movie was, we didn't have a story, but we knew that Meat Loaf had to be in this movie.
See, Jack has gone around in interviews and on TV talking about his movie and saying, I want Meat Loaf to play my dad. Well, every time he does, I get a phone call. The people that were really excited and that call me every time were my two daughters. Dad, Jack did it again. He said he wanted you to play his dad again. Dad, you gotta do it. If they call you, you gotta do it.
And you always write it in the script. Like, just like writing it in makes it happen.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Meat Loaf has not sung in a movie since Rocky Horror Picture Show.
I said, I'm an actor. I'm not a musician. And people just think of me as a musician, and I need to be taken seriously as an actor. So if I sing, they're not gonna take me seriously as an actor.
Dio, can you hear me? I am lost and so alone.
Ronnie James Dio brought his hardcore heavy metal theatricality to the role.
I hear you, brave young jables, you are hungry for the rock. But to learn the ancient methods, secret doors you must unlock. Escape your father's clutches in this oppressive neighborhood. On a journey you must go.
I could detect a twinge of evil and of mystery in Dio. I was not fooled by any sort of polite hellos and goodbyes. He's a twisted creature of rock.
He's got a real legit dark power.
Yeah, that
was really fun to watch, and he brought it. He threw down for the D.
When he came, he brought some heavy metal thunder.
He brought the rolling thunder.
There was actually lightning.
I mean, that voice, his voice is so powerful and so amazing that the first time he sung, he like blew up the microphone.
I think people respond to characters that have a pure agenda, and these guys just want to rock, and it's not at the expense of anybody, and they're not letting anything stay in their way, and they're 100% in touch with their dream and going after it. I think that that's just a good energy for people to have.
It's entertaining. It's funny and fun to... We're just trying to entertain people. That's what movies are for.
This is one of those times where I think this is the movie that finally people will laugh for real. They won't understand what's happening to their body. Because all these years of fake laughing and half laughing.
You're going to have to go back, I think, and see it again. Because you're going to miss a lot during the convulsions of laughter.